Hello everyone, welcome to the final programming class of object-oriented programming in C++. Our college opens again after Bihu. Wish you a belated happy Bihu, happy Lohri, Makar Sankranti and Pongal. And if you are someone outside India who is watching this on the internet, and wish you a happy winter solstice well in advance. Anyway, in this video, we are going to go ahead and write programs. This is our A programming class, and this is our final programming class. So in this video, we are going to look at yet another feature of C++ that enables us to solve a certain problem that may be there. Okay. So even without knowing this feature that we are going to talk about, you can still write good program, complete program. This is not essential, okay, but then it is good from the perspective that it allows us to write program in an easier way. Okay, it is not essential from a programmer's perspective. As a student of this course, it is essential for you. All right, so yeah, keep that in mind. Anyway, before we see what is this that we are going to talk about, before we see this feature that solves a certain kind of problem, let us go ahead and look at the problem first. Okay, so I am going to start writing a program, and as always, I am going to start by including IOStream. And then I'm going to bring the standard namespace into my scope. Alright, now what I want to do is I want to write a function that will take two integers as parameter, and it is going to tell me which of these two integers is the larger one. Alright, so it's going to return an integer, one of these two integers that I pass as function. Right, I'm going to call it greater, because it is going to return the greater of two integers, and it's going to take two integers as parameter. So it's integer x and integer y. I'm calling these two parameters x and y. And what am I going to return? I'm going to first test, is x greater than y? All right, if x is indeed greater than y, then I'm going to return x, otherwise I'm going to return y. Okay, so I hope all of you know this syntax. Whatever I have written here, this is called a ternary operator. All right, this is the condition. This is some logical condition that is checked by your computer, by your processor, when you run this program. And based on the condition check, based on the outcome of this logical test, okay, is x greater than y? That is the test that we are going to do. If the output is yes, is x greater than y? Yes, x is greater than y. If that is the result of this logical test, then I'm going to return x. If x is not greater than y, then I'm going to return y. Alright, so this is essentially what this statement means. If you have confusion regarding this statement, then go ahead and look into your textbook in C that you studied last year. Alright, so this is the function that I have written, a very simple function. Takes two parameter, two integers x and y, tests which of these two x and y, which of these two is bigger, and then returns the whatever is bigger. Alright, a very simple function. I am going to write the main function now that is going to use this function, and I am going to declare two integers, a equal to 5 and b equal to 6. Alright, so I have two integers on my screen right now, and then what I am going to do is I am going to output the bigger of these two numbers. How do I find the bigger of these two numbers? I am going to call this greater method, and I am going to pass a and b as parameter to this greater method, and then I am going to print a new line because I like my output to be better looking. So what's the problem here? Okay. Then I am going to return with a 0. Alright, so this is what I have. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to compile and run this program. Okay, something is wrong. Hold on, let me check. Okay, it seems greater is reserved for some reason. Okay, so we are not going to use that. I'm going to just call it great, and that hopefully is going to solve everything. All right. So I'm compiling, I'm running this program, and yeah, for some reason I cannot call my function greater. Okay, let's not worry about that. So I have this function great, and it returns the greater of this two number. Okay, so I'm passing two parameters, a and b, which holds this value 5 and 6. The function checks which of these two numbers is bigger. 6 is bigger, and therefore the function returns 6, and that is what I print into my standard output. All right, so far so good. Now what I want to do is, instead of finding which of these two integer is greater, I want to find which of these two floats are greater. So 5.5 is a floating point number and 6.5 is a floating point number. Alright, so both of these are floating point number, and let me try to call find which of these is bigger using the function that I have written. Okay, so one thing is good, that we are not getting an error. My program is compiling, so that is fine. Why is my program compiling? Why am I not getting an error? Should I be expecting an error? Maybe I would be expecting an error. Why? Because I have this float A and float B. Both of these are floating point numbers. I am passing two floating point numbers A and B to a function that is expecting integers as parameter. Alright, so there is a bit of a discrepancy in what is being expected and what I am doing. Alright, so why am I not getting an error despite this discrepancy? Right? The reason I'm not getting an error is because internally this typecasting is taking place. All right, so a float can hold a integer. All right, therefore when I pass a float, or a integer can hold a float, both of these works. All right, so when I pass one type to another, automatic casting will take place. So although I am passing this float 5.5 and float 6.5, what is actually being passed are two integers, 5 and 6. So this function great is receiving two integers, 5 and 6. Alright, so it does this condition check, and then it sees that 6 is greater, so it returns 6, and that is what is being printed into my standard output. Alright, so because of internal casting, I'm not getting this error. I'm not getting a syntax error, but then there is a semantic error in this program. Okay, what is the semantic error? I'm trying to find greater of these two floating point numbers. Alright, but the two floating point numbers are 5.5 and 6.5. This function is supposed to return me the greater of these two numbers. Alright, but it returns me, it is returning 6 to me, although 6 is not even a number that I am considering right now. Okay, so I am considering two numbers, 5.5 and 6.5. I am printing 6 as the output, so 6 is not even an option for me. So this is indeed an error. Okay, so what do I do to resolve this error? I write another function. Okay, I know that C++ gives me a very powerful, a very good feature called function overloading. Okay, it means that I can create multiple functions having the same name. So I'm going to write another function with the same name, great. And this time it is going to take two floating point number as parameter, and it is going to return me a floating point number. So taking parameter float x and float y. Alright, and then it is going to do this check and return whichever is bigger. Alright, so this is what it is. This is my new function I have added to my program. Previously I had a function called great that took two integers and returned an integer. Now I have another function called great, same name, but now it takes two float and returns a float. So there is a difference in the a parameter type and a return type, right? Although the name is same, this is object function overloading, and we have discussed this in details in our previous classes, right? So let us go ahead and compile this. Okay, now we are getting the correct output, right? As expected. Now here's the thing. Say now I want to see which of two double is bigger. Okay, what do I do? Do I go ahead and now create the third function called grade? What if I want to then check which of two character is bigger? So do I go ahead and create the fourth function? Now you may come up to me and say, why not simply use double? Double can hold float, double can hold integer, and double can hold character. So one double may be enough for all of these cases. That is something that you might say. But then think about it. When we use float and double, okay, we are using a different type of hardware. See, inside our processor, there is hardware to do integer arithmetic. This integer arithmetic hardware is order of magnitude faster than the hardware that is there that does floating point operation or double operation. Okay, so the hardware to do double is far slower than the hardware to do int calculation, right? So why use, if we are going to add compare and return to integer, why use this hardware that works with float? All right, if we are using if we are going to use compare to character, all right, and we have a function that takes integer as the parameter, so integer requires 4 bytes of data, character requires 1 byte of data, so are we not wasting our space? Okay, so we if we have a program that uses this several times, okay, then what is going to happen is we would be able to if we use character instead of int, we are saving 4 times the space, right? So this is 1 byte, that is 4 bytes. So let's these are some ideas, these are some reason why we should not in general have a very big data like double that is going to hold all these small data like float or int or character, right? Not a very good idea. Okay, so yeah, that is what we have. And moreover, integer and character, they are very precise, right? This double, float, they lose precision because of significant figures, right? So this is one more reason why this is not a good idea, having one single method that does, that we use for all of this. So instead of a single method that works for all of these different data types, function overloading allows us to have different methods with the same name. But then this is also not a good idea. Why? Because how many times are we going to write this method? Okay, do I write this method once for integer, once for character, once for float, once for double? That's a that is an unnecessary thing. Correct. That is the reason we have another feature in C++ that we are going to talk about in this video. All right, this is function template and class template. So I'm going to do a very simple thing. Instead of this two function with the same name, I'm going to have only one function. And instead of fixing the data type of this function, all right, what I'm going to do is I'm going to write template, okay, followed by class T. Okay, this is not the class in the same way in which we use class and object. Okay, this is just a syntax. Then instead of int, I'm going to write T over here. I'm going to write T over here. And I'm going to write T over here. All right. So what am I doing? I am making a generic data type. Okay, so I am saying that there is going to be a data type. The data type can be anything. Okay, I am just calling it T right now. This T, what is T? T can be integer, T can be character, float, double, long, anything at a later point of time. Okay, so right now I'm going to make this function very generic without any specific data type. And I have this T over here. T is my data type. Whatever form it takes, that is something that we will not worry about right now. That is going to happen later. But it can be character, it can be float, integer, double, anything. All right, so this is what it is. This is a function template, okay? A function that does not have a fixed data type. It has a generic data type. All right, now if I try to run this program, I get this. When I run this program, these two floats are being passed, and therefore this automatically becomes a float. Okay. So instead, if I pass two integers, I get this integer as returned. Okay. So what is happening? This is still a float. Okay. Now, if I pass two integers, like I am doing on my screen right now, okay, I am passing two integers, A and B. Both of these are integer. And when I am compiling this program, my compiler sees that what is the type that is being passed over here. It sees that the type of A and B is int. Therefore, what is T? T is an int. Why is that? Is it an int? Because int is the type that is being passed over here. Okay, this is an int. Okay, and so what is T? T is a int. Okay, T is assigned to an integer. And then this essentially becomes int grade, int x, int y. Okay, simple. Now, instead of int, if I have float 5.5 and 6.6, okay, and I execute this program, then now what the compiler sees is that I am passing a float. Therefore, it converts this T into a float. So right now both A and B are float. Therefore, the compiler essentially changes this function into float grade, float x, float y. Okay, instead of T, this T is converted to now float. Okay, so this is what template is. Okay, a very useful. I hope you see the usefulness of this, right? So now let me do one final thing. Instead of let me call using a character. Okay, so A, B is say B. Alright, so I am calling this. Now I am getting that B is greater among A and B. Okay, and that makes sense because the ASCII value of B is greater than the ASCII value of A. So this is what is happening. Okay, so what am I being returned? I am being returned a character. Alright, I am being returned a character. And what is being passed? I am passing two characters to this function. So this T becomes a character. Okay. Okay. There is one thing that I want you to think about. Okay. So this T, okay, this general data type that we have written, this template for the data type. Okay, we did not specify whether it is going to be an int or a char or a float or whatever. Okay, we did not specify that. So how, what is this T? Okay, it is going to be one of these data types, right? So what is this T? That is going to be determined automatically by the compiler during the compilation process, right? So what if we don't want the compiler to determine this automatically? What if we want to specify this? What is the type that T is going to be? We might want to specify this in our program at while writing the program, right? So compiler did not make this guess. Compiler did not decide what T is going to be. All right, so that is what we are going to do now. And this is the syntax. We write this greater than, less than, this bracket. And inside this, we write the data type that we want this T to be. Say, right now, I want T to be character. All right, so I write this. I write after the function name, I write within this brackets, I write what is the type that I want this data type, this T to be, this type name to be. All right, so this is what it is. I go ahead and compile, run this, and everything works like before. Okay, so say I make it a integer. Okay, and so this is 5 and this is 6. Okay, so I'm going to make this a int. Now this T becomes integer, right? So I go ahead and compile this, and this is what happens. Okay, now say I want to make a change to my program. This is not the program that I want. I want my program, my function, not to return anything. So it's going to be void, and the first character is going to be something. The second character, second parameter is going to be a integer. All right, so I am ensuring that second one has to be an integer. So B has to be an integer. Let me keep it in another line. First, A can be anything. Okay, and what I am going to do inside this function is for I int I equal to 0, I less than n, I plus plus, I'm going to simply see out x, okay, whatever is the first parameter. Okay, so this is what we have, and I'm going to go ahead and try to compile this. Okay, sorry, this is not returning anything, so I cannot print anything over here. Okay, so let me go ahead and compile this. Okay, so I have passed 6 as my second parameter, my n, and therefore my first parameter, this 5, is going to be printed 6 times, and that is what is being done. Okay, now instead of printing this integer 5, if I want to print this floating point 5.5, okay, and I have to change this to float, and then I compile and run this. So I am printing 5.5 6 times, all right, and if I change this to character, say A, then it is going to print A 6 times. Alright. Okay, sorry, it is being sent as a float, right? I have. Yeah. So, yeah, that is one interesting that just happened. When I had int or float over here, when I wrote float, I was saying that right now I have written int. I am saying that T has to be a integer. T is going to be an integer, and then when I pass a character over here and I compile and run this, what is happening that this character, okay, I am sending a character, but what I am doing is I am receiving an integer, because I say that T is an integer, right? And then I am printing this integer 6 times. N is equal to 6, I am passing n equal to 6. So I am printing this integer 6 times. What is this integer? When I convert this character A into an integer, I get the ASCII value of that character, right? So I am printing 97, which is the ASCII value of A. I am printing that 6 times. So this is what it is. But I do not want this to be a integer. Alright, I want this to be a character. I want this parameter x to be treated like a character, not like a integer. So therefore, I am writing character over here. T should be a character. This data type T should be a character. Alright, when I do this, now I am printing this character A 6 times. Okay, fine. Next, what might happen is, I am fixing this to be a integer, right? My second parameter. I am saying this has to be an integer. Previously, I had written this where both T and N are going to be the same data type. Okay. So if I had written this, then what is going to happen is I am saying that both X and N are going to be character, because I am saying that this data type T is a character. Alright, I have written char over here. Therefore, both this T and this T, all the T, wherever this T occurs as a template, all of this T are going to be character. Right? But then, right now, I want this X to be treated like a character and this N to be treated like a integer or a float, depending on what I am passing. Okay, so there are two different types that these two different parameters should take. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say that this is u. Okay, I'm going to name this second parameter, this second data type u, and I'm going to write class u over here. Okay, so now this second one is going to be an integer. Okay, now what I'm doing is I am taking this class template over here, this template definition. Okay, this first one is t and second one is u. So when I write within my brackets char and int, I am writing two data types over here, right? The first one is char and the second one is int. Therefore, what is will happen is this, the first data type, this t, is going to be whatever I am specifying over here. I am specifying that the first one is going to be char. Therefore, t is going to be a char. What is my second data type in my template definition? It is u. What is the second data type over here? I am saying the second one is u. Okay. Second one is int. Therefore, u is going to be an int. Now, in this function, when I call this function by specifying that t is going to be a char and u is going to be an int, this x is of type t. What is t? T is a char. Therefore, x becomes a character. What is n? N is u. What is u? U is int. Therefore, n becomes int. Correct? So I should not see any difference in the output when I execute this program, and I do not see any difference as expected. Alright. Now say I am passing a float over here. And sorry for the interruption. Say I'm passing a float 6.5. Okay, so I'm writing float. I still should not see any difference. I'm going to tell you why. But then what is going to happen now is this x is going to be a character. Okay, and this n is going to be a float. Okay, let me go ahead and run this program. I do not see any difference because here I assign I to an integer and I should be less than 6. Okay, there is a difference. Okay, previously I was less than 6, so when I became 6 and this became 6, n was 6, and when I became 6, it broke out of this for loop, right? So I was printing a 6 times. Now n has the value 6.5. okay, n can have the value 6.5 because I am saying that n is a float. Okay, previously n was a int with value 6. All right, so now I am printing, when I has the value 6, it checks 6 is less than 6.5, true. Therefore it prints a again. Therefore now a is being printed 7 times. But then if I do this, if I change this to int, okay, then what happens is this n becomes an integer. Although I am passing 6.5 to n, okay, this casting is taking place, and n actually ends up holding the value 6 from 6.5. instead of 6.5, n holds the value 6. All right, when I say that n is an integer, now instead of printing a 7 times, I am going to end up printing a 6 times. All right, so yeah, this is what it is. Now the application of this, there might be lots of different applications of this. All right, so there is no point in me trying to figure out application. You can think of application. One application is there in your lab. Okay, you have to write a stack using this template. This stack I can use as a stack of integer, a stack of character, or a stack of double, whatever I want. All right, you are going to write the same piece of code, and that is going to work with any data structure. Now you can see one good advantage of this. Had you written a stack with a double or with a integer, say, okay, and I would have used that to store character, then I would be wasting 4 times the space that I needed. Okay, if I say needed 1 MB of space, then I would have used 4 MB of space. Now with template, I am actually using the amount of space that I need. All right, additionally, had you written a stack for integer, then if I needed a stack for long, or I needed a stack for double, then you would have had to write this program again. Okay, that would have been inefficient from a programming perspective. Right, so this is one advantage of template. Okay, now this is one application of template, the advantage that template gives us. Now I'm not going to spend too much time on this, but I'm going to show you one final thing before moving on. Say I am now saying that car, and this is a float. Okay, all right, so right now what is going to happen is this template, this U, is going to take the data type float, right? So we already discussed this, that our first template type would be a car, the second one would be a flow, that is what we had specified inside these brackets, and that means that my first type, this T, is going to be a car, that is what I had specified first, and the one that I specify second, float, is going to be assigned to this. So U is going to be a float. All right, now say instead of float I write int. All right, so when I write int, what is going to happen is this U is going to be an int. All right, so there should not be any confusion about why that is happening right now. U is now going to be an int, therefore this n is going to be an int. All right, that is what we assign the data type to be. Now what I can do is I can set U to be a U to have some default type, right? For example, using this syntax over here, I am assigning you to have the data type int. Alright. So if I have that, then I don't need to specify the data type of u. Okay. Now I am not specifying the data type of u. Therefore, what that means is this u is going to take the data type int. Okay. Now let me go ahead and compile this. Okay, this is what I have. Now if I specify this to be float, okay, then what is going to happen? This u is going to take the data type float. Right, so I compile and run this, and this is what I have. This is my output. Right, so if I don't specify the second parameter, then what is going to happen? This u's default type is going to be taken. And if I specify something over here, then whatever I specify is going to be assigned as the data type wherever u appears. Right, so this is what it is. Like we have default parameters, in the same way we have default value for parameters, in the same way we have default types for templates. All right. Now let me get back to one template, one type T. Okay, let me not have all this. And I am going to have a class. All right, so class say complex. And then this is going to have public some t real and t imaginary, and say I have a constructor complex that takes as parameter t r and t I. And what this constructor is going to do is it is going to assign R to real and I to imaginary. I to imaginary. So this is the constructor. Let me end this class complex. And here I am going to, let me do one more thing. I am going to print out sorry for the interruption, although you did not see any interruption. So I am going to keep on writing this constructor called, and I am going to end this line. Okay, so this is what I have. Now let me create an object out of this class. So it's a class is complex, and I have to specify what is the type that this T is going to take. So I have some template type, T, and it has to now be something real, right? Means there is, instead of writing T, now I have to replace this T with an actual data type. So right now I am going to have integer. All right. And I am going to have this object, and I am going to pass 10, 20, right? So so I have created this object over here in line number 16, and in line number 20 I am going to print this object, right? So I have specified that the template T is going to be an integer. Okay, this T is going to be an integer. Therefore, wherever I have specified this data type to be T, for example, this real and imaginary, I have specified that they are going to be T. What is T? Here in line number 16, I am specifying that t is integer. Therefore, real and imaginary, which I wrote as t, are going to be integer. In the same way, here in this parameter that I am passing, this t over here and this t, both of these are going to be integer. All right. So let me go ahead, compile and run this program. And yeah, this constructor is called. When calling this constructor, I do this assignment and then I print this real number. Object.real is 10, so that is being printed. This plus is printed, then object.imaginary is 20. 20 is being printed and then I. Alright, next what I'm going to do is instead of having this real and imaginary part as integer, I'm going to instead make them float. Right? So this is the simple thing that I do. I make this simple change and that changes the data type. Now t becomes a float. Alright, therefore this real part, imaginary part, all these things, wherever I have written t, all of them becomes float. Alright, let me compile and run this program. And now we can see that this real part and imaginary part of the object, they are floating point numbers. I see these fractional points over here. Alright. Next, let me demonstrate. This is the final thing that we are going to do in our today's video. That, see, I have written real as one type and imaginary as some other type. I can have both of them as the same type, right? Both of them with T. I can have them as different things. So real will be T, imaginary will be U. So this will be T and this will be U. Okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to assign T to be float and U to be float as well. Or let me do one. Yeah. Let me keep U as float. So both T and U, that is both real and imaginary, are float. Both R and I are float. Because T and U, both of them are float, therefore I should not see any change in my output. Previously I had only T and T was float. Now I have T and U, but still both of them are float. So no change in my output. Let me change this to int. Alright, now U becomes int. Therefore imaginary part should become integer. This parameter that I am passing should be an integer. This assignment will be an assignment of an integer to an integer. And let me see what happens with when I compile this. Okay, see the difference. This imaginary part, I am passing a floating point number, but then I am getting only an integer number. Okay, so I see a difference in my output as expected, right? So float and int. All right. So this is what I have. Now let me do this. I have removed this int. Let me try to compile. I get an error because I have two templates and I am specifying type of only one template. So let me do one thing. Let me make this an integer. Let me make this int by default. Okay. So now U should be in by default. Let me go ahead compile. And U becomes int. That is the default value that I take. I don't need to specifically write over here. But then because I am passing a floating point over here, image should be assigned to a floating point. But because U is int, so I am taking an integer as a parameter, right? Although I am passing a floating point, I am actually receiving an integer, right? Therefore, assignment of integer to integer is taking in line number 11. And when I try to print this imaginary, which is an integer, I see that a integer is being printed. All right, so far so good. I have this second parameter. I am not explicitly specifying what is the type that this second template should take, that this U should take. So since I'm not explicitly specifying, whatever is specified by default is what is being assigned. Okay, if I do not have anything as default over here, if I don't have anything as default over here, then I'm going to get an error because two parameters should be expected here. I'm passing this, there are two templates that are defined here. I am assigning value type to only one template, so that's an error. So I have a default now, this error goes away. If I don't specify, I no longer get an error. The default is being assigned, so everything is good. Now, instead of this default, when I write this, when I don't specify anything over here, I simply have one single float, then the default u becomes an integer, so I get I am printing an integer. So I don't want u to be integer. I don't want u to be to take the default assigned type. All right, I want it to be a float. So now u will become a float, and instead of 20i, I will be printing 20.5i. Right, so I am passing this float as parameter, and I am now actually receiving a float because u is now a float. So I am receiving a float inside this constructor, and I am assigning a float to this imaginary. Right, so imaginary is also a float, u is a float. U is, although you would have taken a integer as you would have been an integer as the default type, but I am specifying that it should be a float. Right, so this is what it is. This is all about template. There is nothing much to do over here. I, as part of your laboratory experiment and as part of your assignment, you have this same problem. You have to implement this stack ADT using template. So what you have to do is you will write this entire program for stack. You will have an array of, say, how do you have created a stack? You using either a linked list or an array, right? So say you would have had an array of integer, then you would have had a push function and a pop function. So into this push you would have passed a integer as parameter. This pop function would have returned an integer, right? Now what you are going to do is, instead of passing a integer as parameter, instead of passing an integer as parameter to push, instead of this pop returning an integer, instead of having an array of integers, you are going to have an array of generic type t. This push is going to take generic template t. Okay, this pop is going to return t, and then when I use this stack class that you are going to make, at that point of time I am going to specify whether this t, this array of t, this push that takes a t, this pop that returns a t, what is this t going to be? Is it going to be an integer? Is it going to be an array of integer? Is it going to be float? Is it going to be character? That is something that I will specify when I use the class that you are going to make. Alright, so that is part of your assignment. I am pretty sure you are going to do it properly. So this ends our programming class. We are no longer going to have any more programming classes in this course. We are going to have more classes, of course. We are going to have say three more classes before we end this course. This brings to an end the C++ portion of our course, the object-oriented programming portion of our course. Alright, I'm going to have a review video on C++ where we are going to discuss in theory some of the things that we have been programming in the last few classes. But after that, we are going to start looking at designs. What are some good object-oriented design? What are design pattern? Alright, so see you in the next class. Next class is probably going to be a review class, and then we are going to start looking at designs. We are going to have two classes on designs, and that would be the end of the course. The end is not far away. I hope you have been studying properly. Exam might be offline, so do not take things lightly. Best of luck, study properly, submit your assignments. See you in the next video.